Morning. Good morning to our Greater Nation family.
Yes. Happy Resurrection Sunday from Greater Community to you. Happy Resurrection Sunday to you as well.
And same to you.
Listen, I'm glad to be here. He is risen. You can see behind us. It says that he has risen. Christ the Savior is risen.
Yes.
We are excited to be at the culmination of Holy Week for us, Passion Week, some churches call it. And we have been, well, all month we've been walking to Calvary. That's our theme for the month.
Yes.
But all week this week, we definitely have been walking to Calvary, walking to Sunday, walking to Resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about this week's, all that we've been through? So think about from Wednesday to Sunday. Like, just tell us, let's talk a little bit about that.
Absolutely. This week, I think for possibly the first time, I know I've been here a few years, but I think for myself, I will say this has been the first year that I've literally walked in the steps that it took for Christ to get to where he went on the cross. I mean, just, oh my goodness, from Wednesday night, we had an awesome speaker.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my
mm-hmm.
goodness, tore the house down.
Definitely.
And then Thursday, where we did the sacraments, that was an absolute blessing, from feet washing, Holy Communion, and
congratulations
baptism.
On being baptized.
Definitely,
congratulations.
I was so excited.
That.
Yeah. It's really been... It's been a journey.
Yes.
It really has been. I mean, just personally, spiritually, it has been a blessing for me. How about you?
Definitely for me, too. I think, too, it's the events of thinking about. So we hear the scriptures and the stories because, you know, you're 30, I'm over 40, right? So we have heard the scriptures and we've heard vacation Bible school stories,
right?
Sunday school and all that. But to literally take the days and kind of slow it all down.
Mm.
And I think even culminating with prayer on yesterday that we had on the grounds,
wonderful.
Pastor was saying that we have to slow, just quiet all the noise and slow down and think about. And this week, like you as well, I've participated several times, but it's about being in the experiences and being in the journey and learning about the events that happen on the days leading up to Resurrection Sunday, right?
Mm-hmm.
Also, yesterday's prayer on Holy Saturday,
my goodness,
was also powerful. And Pastor talked about like the Saturday when they were waiting.
Living in the Saturday.
And because, we could relate, right?
My goodness. I mean, we know he died on Friday.
Yeah.
And we almost skip over Saturday, but we have to sit in the fact that he still was in the tombs.
Right.
He had to go descend to hell, as Pastor talked about,
just
to make sure to conquer it. Okay.
Yes.
For all of us.
Yes.
Just because we didn't see the work happening in the physical, in the spiritual, God was tearing things down.
And can we relate to that today?
Oh my goodness. Okay.
Yes.
So forgive me and my excitement. Okay.
No, for real.
It was absolutely amazing. And today.
Yeah. Today.
Oh my goodness. Today. He rose.
We celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ today, our Savior. We're excited. Yeah. We want to invite you to our services that we have each and every week. Our WOW on Wednesdays. We have Manhood Ministries and Sister Care on every third Friday. We have children's programming. Download our app, My GCC app, because you can find all of our programming that's happening each and every week, each and every day here. But today is Resurrection Sunday. So invite a friend to join us. Tag them in the chat. Make sure that you're sharing this. Go to our YouTube channel, subscribe, and just really spend time reflecting on the life that Jesus gave as a sacrifice. It's time to head into worship. Are you ready for worship?
I am ready.
We are ready to go. We'll see you in the chat. Stay in his face
and journey well.
Toward us, we praise. Come on, let's take it back from the top. Oh Lord, we give you praise. Come on, everybody, sing it. Oh Lord. Oh Lord. And your name.
Yeah. Hallelujah. And not only is he risen, but he's coming back again. Hallelujah. We have something to look forward to. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is coming back again. Hallelujah. I'm excited to be here today. I don't know about you. Hallelujah. But I'm excited to be in the house of the Lord. Glory to God. As we move further into our worship, amen, we're going to open with a hymn, one of the hymns that we love here at Greater so much. In Christ alone. Y'all see, Pastor loves this hymn because it speaks of our walk with him. It speaks of our hope in him. It speaks of our trust in him. And it speaks of our expectation. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The words are going to be on the screen. I want you to lift your voice with us on this morning as we sing. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this cornerstone. And get my lyric back. But hold on, we're going to do this again. We're going to do this again because we want to do it together. Amen. Do you see it? All right, here we go. In Christ alone. Let's try it. guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power, here. Come on, let's say that one more time. No power, no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. He returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'm saved. Hallelujah! 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 We're in the midst of a celebration today. We're in the midst of a celebration today. And we got a new addition tonight, today, to the Judah Flag Ministry. I think you're going to be blessed by her. Amen. Come on, put your hands together with us. Thank you. God. He is our King. Come on, put your hands together, everybody. Come on, lift up the name of Jesus. He's worthy. Hallelujah. He is our King.
Majesty, power, righteousness, oh glory, both now and
my strong power and strength. morning, greater community. What a blessing it has been this morning to see all your beautiful faces, all the beautiful attire. It's truly a blessing to see you on today. I am Evelyn Boyce, and this handsome gentleman next to me is my husband, Jonathan Boyce. We stand before you this morning to welcome you into the house of the Lord. If you're here in the sanctuary or you're joining us from one of our streaming platforms, on behalf of Bishop Brown and the entire greater community family, we are so happy you chose to worship with us on this Resurrection Sunday. We invite you in to sing with us, to pray with us, and to give God the glory on this celebration.
We've had such an eventful week, Holy Week, which has led us to this moment of Resurrection Sunday. I don't know about you, but we started with rehearsal on Tuesday, the HBCU preacher on Wednesday, the sacraments on Thursday, the seven last words on Friday, face-to-face prayer on Holy Saturday. Listen, Greater, how about you give yourselves a hand for your faithfulness? Here at Greater Community, under the leadership of our pastor, Bishop Matthew Brown, we are intentional about seeking the kingdom of God and bringing kingdom to the community. Now, everyone, let's stand to our feet and let's greet each other the best way we know how. Greater, let's show our visitors that God is doing something wonderful here in our lives. Welcome.
God is doing something.
Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Greetings, everyone. I'm Pastor Matthew Brown. I ran downstairs because there's 75 to 100 people in the fellowship hall. And I wasn't going to let them feel like they were disconnected because they're not in the sanctuary. I need somebody to go ahead and say thank God for them. Clap your hands for them. Welcome them to Greater Community Church of God in Christ. I'm so glad he got up. So I can go and sit down. Jesus done wore me out. But will you say, I'm glad he's risen?
They didn't shout at the tomb.
because they wasn't sure what was happening. But we know the rest of the story. 3 days later, he got up with all power in his hand. So why don't you shout for the disciples? Shout for Peter. Shout for John. Shout! He's not here. He is risen, as he said. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. I am so glad. I am so glad the Lord is risen. Happy Resurrection Day. We know 2,000 years ago he rose from the dead. But this is the Superbowl of Christianity. Heaven and hell were fighting, and heaven won. Thank you, Lord. And we have eternal life. You've been welcome to our church. Let me move on, because we're not going to keep you long. We've been walking to Calvary all month long through 40 days of Lent. We've moved through the Holy Week, and we've celebrated. The reason why we have such a different perspective is because we've sacrificed to be with him and all the things that he has declared. But what I'm not willing to do is I'm not willing to disrupt our worship service to create a presentation of Christ for people to be amazed by him. We want you to be transformed by him. So glad that we serve in a ministry where we don't have to put on. We don't have to figure out what we're going to do. We're not renting helicopters and dropping eggs. The only thing we're doing is say, come see a man. Since January, we've launched the Jeremiah Generation Project, where we are committed as a ministry to minister to the next generation from the ages of 5 to 6 to 18, to equip our kids so that they can go into classrooms and not be attacked by their faith or be silenced because they are not equipped to defend it. Through our Sunday school and our youth departments, we have been ministering to our children. Today, we're going to culminate a super seed offering for them. I'm going to ask that you would participate when that time comes. If you will help us and sow into this ministry, we'll be able to minister to this generation in ways and unusual ways. God has given us early returns in the first quarter. Over 65 teenagers have given their lives to Christ and have made a public confession of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. They're being baptized. They're in our affirmation Sunday schools. They're leading in ministry. We're connecting them. We're putting them in places. We're not creating a space for the program of children. We're raising them up to walk with us as we walk with God. And since January, members of our church have sent pictures of their children. Members that do not live in Georgia, our members that are all around the country. And as we pray every service, we lift up our kids. If you'd like for your child to be prayed for the rest of this year, the only thing you have to do is send us a digital picture of your child and send it to info@gc-cogic.com. That's info
at gc-cogic.com. We'll continue to build more of these murals, and every service we're praying for your children. We're believing God for them. And so in our church, what we do is we pray and we prophesy. We decree and declare over their lives. And on Resurrection Day, I'm not concerned about who's sitting next to you. I'm concerned about what's in them. What's inside the person sitting next to you? Maybe you have a need. Maybe there is an unmet need. Maybe your tomb is still occupied. But Jesus is risen from the dead that we might be saved. A number of our children are in the Kingdom Center being ministered to, giving them time to simply fellowship because they did a great job this morning. We're not going to expect little kids to sit still for another service. But if you have a child between the ages of 5 and 18, and maybe they're with you, we invite you to come to the altar, and we invite you to bring your children. One of the things we've learned since January is that we are reacquainting parents, children, and the altar. Because we moved away from the altar. We've moved away from a place where we come to cry out to God and believe. I'm going to ask our resident ministers, missionaries, to please make sure that someone is downstairs in the fellowship hall so that as we begin to pray, we pray for those that are there. Somebody please let me know if we're okay, because I don't want anyone in this building to walk away without us covering them and their children in prayer. I believe God. We have educators who last quarter sent us pictures of them laying on the floor in their classroom with locked doors because of active shooters. We're sending our kids into supposed places of safety, and we don't know whether they're going to come home and be okay. People are suffering and have diagnoses and needing prayer. Prayer changes things. So today I'm going to ask Elder and Sister McTall to come now, as they will lead us in this time of covering our children. Maybe you have a need. Come to the altar. Nobody's going to slap you down. Nobody's going to grease you up. We simply want to pray with you. If you have children, bring them. We'll save your seat. Hallelujah. Seats are premiums. And this, listen, you can't save a seat. Just scooch over. But will you please say, I want my child covered. I believe God as we come to this altar, as we pray, and as we believe God.
Truly, we just want to continue to celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. For we thank God for allowing His Son Jesus to die on the cross, that we might have a right to the tree of life. We serve a risen Savior, and we thank and praise you now. We glorify your name. Come, 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 come. Come, 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 come. Lord God, we just thank you for this time. We thank you, oh God, for all of our young people, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for how you've blessed them, oh God, to see another day, oh God. We thank you for how you kept them. We thank you for the ways that you constantly make for them, oh God. We thank you for the open door, oh God. We thank you for your arms of protection, oh God, seen and unseen, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you protect them as they go to and as they go forth. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, allow them to carry you in their hearts and their minds, oh God. Save our young people, oh God. Help them to be a light in this world, oh God. Be with them, oh God. Stand up in them, oh God. Strengthen them in every leaning side, oh God.
build them up where they're torn down, oh God. Strengthen them where they're weak, oh God. Lift them up in you, oh God, that they may be the light that you're calling for in these last and evil days. Oh God, break them out of, oh God, depression, oh God. Break them out of weariness, oh God. Break them out of tiredness, oh God. In the name of Jesus, let them stand, oh God, for holiness. Let them stand for what is right, oh God. Let them stand, oh God, for holiness, oh God. Help them to be holy, for you are holy. Help them to live right, oh God. Touch their minds, oh God. Let this mind be in them that is also in Christ Jesus. Oh God, strengthen them now, oh God. Give them peace in their hearts, oh God. Peace to their minds, oh God. Have thine own way in them, oh God. Show them how much you love them, oh God. Oh God, you showed us the ultimate sacrifice, oh God, for allowing your son Jesus to die on the cross. And because he lives, oh God, help them to live also, oh God. Lord, because he reigns, oh God, reign in them, oh God, in every heart, in every mind, and every soul, oh God. Be with them and keep them, oh God. Even in the hard places, help them to stand, oh God. Don't let them give up, oh God. We shall not give up on our young people, oh God. We will hold them up in prayer. Oh God, we will pray them through to their destiny, oh God, that they may be the young people that you're calling for, oh God. Lord God, break them out of fear. Break them out of shame, oh God. When their hands go to do the things that are not like thee, oh God, turn them around, oh God. Speak to their hearts, oh God. Speak to their minds, oh God. In the matchless name of Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Now, Lord, we give you praise. We thank you for your touch. We thank you, Lord, for your word. For it says, ye are of God, little children, and you have overcome them. And greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So we thank you for the victory. Thank you, God, because they are triumphant. They are victorious. You are the risen Lord and the risen King who came that they would get up from where they are and live unto you. So we thank you even now, Lord, as our children grow, God, that they grow in grace, that they grow with the applied grace of God on their life, that they grow up knowing, God, that you died for them, God. And we thank you for the receipts, God, that they are more than conquerors through you who love them, oh God. You come to destroy the yoke and break them free from the very bondage and the chain that tried to hold them down. But we thank you today, for you raise them up, God, and you give them victory over the devil. We thank you today, God, because you bless them, oh God, and save them and deliver them from the attacks of those things seen and unseen. And we bless your name for it. Now, God, we thank you, and we pray your continuing blessing over them. And we hold to your hand and not the hand of the world. Hallelujah. For you said, I give you power over serpents and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. So we thank you for no hurt on our young people. We thank you because they are covered with the blood in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now let me tell you this. The Lord said this, that you are positioned. You are positioned. You are positioned for possession. You are positioned for possession of the Lord. You are positioned, hallelujah, for the possession of God's blessing on your life. So we give God praise because we stand in the position to receive the Lord Jesus Christ. Even so, come Lord Jesus, for he's soon to come. And we are positioned for the coming of the Lord. So we thank you, God, because you're taking care of the details. The details is already done. He knows the details. And it's already done. We positioned for them. Now give them praise. In your position, give them praise. Give them glory. Yes.
Amen. We thank God for our youth. We thank God for our children. We thank God for this Jeremiah generation that he is raising up. Amen. As we are in this last Sunday of this month, and we know that it is Easter, but it's Resurrection Sunday, as we say. It is the last Sunday of Women's History Month,
and to take nothing away from Resurrection Sunday, because if I must say so myself, the women were the first to see him. Amen. The women were the first to witness that he's alive. Hey.
To every man that's in the house, brothers, just stand up and repeat after me. Yeah, 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 yeah.
We still love you. Praise the Lord. We're not going to get into a war. I got a couple of things in my mind right now, but I'm just going to let it stay right there. Pastor taught us about shut mouth grace. So I'm going to keep my mouth shut. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm not going to say it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But we are going to honor again. Women, we've been honoring women all month long, and we didn't want to do any different today. And I reached out to this wonderful young woman, and I asked her if she would prepare a spoken word to go along with our presentation. So would you please receive our very own Hannah Watson, MDiv. I would say...
If you're looking for... where women are forgotten. Look at him. Looking back at us. See him tenderly weeping for the world, for Jerusalem, for Lazarus, for you and for me. Seeing us as we really are. Seeing us, the women he loves. Like just like the one at the well. His words wore down her world-weary heart. We don't know her name, but Jesus does. Or see the one who bleeding reached out to him. His hem healed her, made desert of her fountain. For 12 years, she was untouchable, too red, too woman. Till Jesus welcomed her wild femininity, he saw her.
My God.
See the women who Jesus set free death, demons, and disease crumble at his touch, and they stood up, finally seen. And then they bowed down, poured their worship like oil at his feet, like Mary. See Martha, see Joanna, Susanna, see the one who they have seen. Jesus loves women. Jesus cares for women. Jesus remembers women and raises our dead. Jesus calls women. Jesus praises women, laid down his very life for women. So see him hanging there on the cross, looking down at his mother looking back at him. Looked like God finally raised him up to change something. See the rivers running down her cheeks, down his side, her baby boy crucified. The women watched and waited and wept the whole night through, and morning and evening, and waiting and weeping and mourning again. See the women at his tomb, expecting nothing but grave and its eternal gray. They rose up early to clean his wounds, but found no body there. Just blazing white and break of day, they ran. He is raised, they proclaimed. And everything he ever said, it's all true. They ran, world's first gospel preachers, bearers of good news. They ran. He is raised. And if we die with him, we'll be raised too. They ran. He is raised, they proclaim. And we shall be raised. Like summer dew on the heat of the day, like all the prayers our grandmothers prayed. He is raised, and we shall be raised. No longer ignored, but received, saved. He is raised, and we shall be raised. He is raised, and we shall be raised. He is raised, and we shall be raised. He is raised, and we shall be raised.
Such gifting and such anointing. Amen. You will see, we want this to continue. These husbands sent these pictures in, and we're going to show them. Praise the Lord. They had to start the video over because of some issues downstairs, but we want you to see these wonderful women of Greater Community.
Happy Resurrection Sunday, Greater Community. My name is Stephen Adams Jr., and I'm a proud member of the Greater Community Church. We have some important announcements for the month of April, and I need you to give us your full attention.
Today is the last day for our Jeremiah Generation Super Seed 2024.
Wait, did you hear what they just said? The Jeremiah Generation Super Seed campaign ends today. If you have not already given to support my generation, you can still do so now. If you look on the screen, you will find the ways to give. On behalf of my generation, thank you for your contribution.
We are thrilled to bring you the latest and greatest events happening this April. That's right. Mark your calendars for a special evening on April 28th at 6 p.m. for our Sunday night call to worship, an international time of worship and prophetic exhortation in the presence of God. It's going to be a powerful experience you won't want to miss.
And don't forget about Sunday School. Every Sunday at 9:45, Elder and Missionary McTaw are your go-to point persons for spiritual growth and enlightenment.
Plus, we've got something for everyone throughout the week. Join us for WOW with a special Ignite WOW session for our youth on the first and third Wednesdays.
Need some extra care and support? Look no further than Sister Care and Manhood's Men Ministry meeting on the third Friday of every month.
Families, bring your kids to Ignite Atmosphere and Kids Connections Children's Church on the second and fourth Sundays for a fun and engaging time of learning and fellowship.
And speaking of fellowship, don't miss out on Kingdom Cafe on the third Sundays after 8 and 11 a.m. services. It is the perfect opportunity to connect over a delicious meal.
Need prayer? We've got you covered. Join us in person for prayer every weekday at 9 a.m. with additional sessions on Tuesday and Fridays at 12 noon.
At Greater Community, we believe in getting connected and involved. Stop by the Ask Me room after this service for more information on how you can join our various ministries and make a difference in our community.
You all know that we are intentional about bringing kingdom to community.
These have been your GCC announcements.
Stay blessed and see you at our next gathering.
For the women, we love y'all. For our children, we praise the Lord. Beloved, we're taking a moment because since February 4th, we have been talking about the Jeremiah Generation Super Seed campaign to end it on Resurrection Sunday. And today we have the opportunity, many of you have given. I'm going to ask that you would just be functional with us, interactional for a moment. If you have not downloaded our app, My GCC app, you have an opportunity to download our mobile app now. It will literally provide you with the ministry of Greater Community at your mobile device. For you that have that app and have connected to Givelify, if you go to Givelify, or if you have it on a separate app, you will see Greater Community is 406 Roswell Street, and part of the tabs it says Super Seed. You can actually give directly there. Today I want to appeal to you that our children need our help. If there's nothing more fundamental of being a parent, it is looking out for your seed. It is saying to them that we're going to be intentional about making sure that our investment in you will give a return to the world. And so we have asked members of our church for individual pledges. We've asked them for family pledges. We've asked them for community pledges, meaning that you would talk to other people, that you would, I don't know how many of you are familiar that you grew up in church, just real quick. Just let me see something. How many didn't? Just raise your hands. I didn't grow up in church. I don't know what y'all doing. Good. That's what I want to talk to you. What happened is a lot of times the church, and particularly, and I'm not doing anything racial. I'm just being honest. The African-American church, the black church, did a lot of stuff because it was the center of the community. The black church was the first school. The black church was the community center. The black church was the theater. The black church was the church and everything that we did there. The churches grew because they understood the value of cooperative economics. In Swahili, ujamaa, the whole concept of cooperative economics. And so they would have pew rallies. If they needed windows, then all of you on this pew would say that we're going to raise $100 so that we can put windows in. And so if we had 30 pews, you get what I'm saying. It's always been the same way. Nothing has changed. And we don't do pew rallies, but I'm not against them. And maybe that's a good idea. But the point that I'm making is we have asked members of our church, we've asked members who consistently give, and now we're going to ask you to give again. If you're not, if this is your first time in our church, please listen to me. You're under no obligation to give. We don't bring people to church for money. I promise you that we host the presence of God, and God will supply. And if you are a regular giver, you say, Pastor, I had a friend tell me, he said, I was asking me, how you doing? You doing a lot this week? I said, yeah, man. I'm just pressing through. They said, well, listen, don't die because it ain't my pay week. I said, what? Ain't nobody got time to be buying tickets to come see you. These are my friends. This may not be your pay week, but if you could give for our children, please listen to me, greater community. Your tithe should not be your supersede. But I will give you dispensation that whatever your offering was going to be, it can be the supersede, but not your tithe. The tithe, let me tell you why. Because in, depending on where you go, we count the tithe sacred. It is the set aside that says that we want this investment in ministry for all of its purposes. And our children are part of that. But today I'm going to ask you that will feel so led of the Lord, as SJ said, thank you for giving to his generation. Greater community, right now, our sanctuary is full, our fellowship hall is full, and our kingdom center is full. We got a good problem because we're growing, but then it creates a whole nother problem. There's no place to park. I get it. But it's important that we steward what God gives us and that we do that well. Today I'm going to ask that you would prayerfully consider sowing a gift into the lives of our church, not your tithe. That should be different. If you need offering envelopes, the ushers are on the floor. If you want to write checks, you can write checks to Greater Community. We're putting our giving platforms on the screen so that you can mobily give. I want to thank God for the members of our church. One brother drove by and said, Pastor, I'm outside because he could not get out the car. And I said, okay, I came outside. We were talking. And then in talking, he wrote a check for $5,000 for the Jeremiah Generation Partnership. Another couple new to our ministry, supportive, and I praise God for them. I didn't even get the words out of my mouth when I was thinking about it last year, and they had already made a commitment of $5,000. Let's thank God for them. No, would you clap for them like you gave it? This is not about comparisons of gifts. It's not equal gifts, it's equal sacrifices. And I said to you that I would give $2,000, and I've given that $2,000 for this campaign. I'm asking you, if you need an offering envelope, you can write your check. If you'd like to use your credit card, you can do that. We will secure that. It's also with our offering envelope. But I'm praying that you will utilize either our Cash App, but you have to mark supersede so that we can direct these funds to where they ought to be. I'm trusting God today that God will give to us We have a goal of $30,000. Because what we need to do is we need to invest in our building. We need equipment for our children. The Kingdom Center is full. We're now going to have to utilize other spaces around Marietta to host our youth department. So it's not just the church campus. It's what we're calling the city campus. We're going to have to make connections with the Salvation Army. It's a good thing to do. And if somebody would say, you need a bigger church, great. Well, in Cobb County, you need 5 contiguous acres of land. Then you need multiple parking spaces with that land. And the average building is going now for $7 million. So if y'all want to hang out and do this. No, and listen, it's doable. I'm not afraid of that, but I ain't going by myself. Go ahead, Pastor. And you be out there on your own. Didn't nobody tell him to go? So we're going to do the best we can with what we have until the Lord gives us favor. Touch your neighbor and say, I'm sorry, but did God speak to you to bless this church? Do you have land that you need to deed? Are we in your will? I ain't playing. Is there legacy giving? I'm just believing God. I believe that God has assigned somebody to bless everybody in this house. And listen, that's why you don't press people for offering. Anybody besides me have given until you've given out? And listen, when I don't have it, I just sit there and smile and thank God because I done gave. Ain't nobody feeling bad. Oh, I need. Don't fake the offering either. Don't grab an envelope, put nothing in it, and walk up here. I know every temple trick there is. You're okay. It's not a problem. God is going to bless us because this is the Lord's church. But I want to take time to ask you to partner with God and partner with us. If you're going to give that seed, or if you're giving that seed, or if you've given that seed to our Jeremiah Generation Project, can I just have you stand if you've given on your mobile device? I'm not calling out amounts. I'm not calling out names. I just need some evidence that, God, we did what you told us. Now do what you said. Hallelujah. Thank you for standing. Thank you for standing. Thank you for standing. Thank you. Whatever amount you've given, we're trusting the Lord. Now, if this is your tithe and you have an offering envelope, I need you to raise that offering envelope, raise it so I can see it, and then pass it to the person that is on the end of the row near the center aisle. When you've collected the offering envelopes that may be in your row, I'm going to ask the person on the end of the row to please stand. And then our ushers are just going to simply come and receive those envelopes. They will place them in this repository, and our offering will be concluded. Now, did y'all want me to raise the offering the way I was raised in the church? Because Deacon Wesley Lambert, I ain't forgot. I need a $100 line here. I need a $500 line over here. And the $1,000 line starts right here. And the Lord will bless you with a cabbage and a Cadillac in 5 days. Now, don't get me started. Don't act like I ain't forgot. Reverend Ike's line, change in the service, makes me nervous. You need a soft offering. No clanging in this house. Come on, ushers, receive the gifts. I want to say to our friends that are visiting us, I pray that for you that are in the fellowship hall, thank you for your gift. Thank you for giving. And as we dismiss, I want you to please hear me. We're going to ask those in the fellowship hall to leave a little early so that I can welcome you right out in our main doors to come straight out. We want to say thank you for being with us. Hallelujah. Thank you for your gifts. Now let's celebrate that everyone has given. We praise the Lord for you today. Thank you for your gifts. No, come on. Let's believe God. We're going to get to that goal, whether we get to it today, next week, next month. We're going to get to the goal because God would never give us a project that he does not already have provision for. And that provision is through you and I. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. Let's worship. One more thing. You'll hear more about this next Sunday. But for members of Greater, if you have children that are between, oh, I forgot the ages. I think the ages are 6 to 17, our Jeremiah generation ages. Greater Community will be sponsoring its first vacation Bible school. So this is what we want you to do. We need you to block off the dates. It's only a half a day. We're starting because we need volunteers. Touch your neighbor and say, you got something to do. Oh, you know, the church, we need, and you stay home. We need, and you never come. June 10th through the 14th will be our vacation Bible school. We'll give you more information as that when that date approaches. I want to take a quick moment, one last thing. Going on 5 years, I and my siblings, we lost our mother. Like anybody, first of all, I need to define I'm a straight up man. That's all I am, but I am a man that cries. Because I am a mama's boy. That's just the way it is. I'm not going to cry, but I'm just telling you. And I'm telling all the brothers in the room that, you know, there's no love like your mom. There's no apologies for that. No love like your mom. In 2019, I was named bishop by the Church of God in Christ in the General Assembly. And I got in a car with another dear friend, Bishop Cedric Daniels, who in his car called my mom to tell her that her son had been named bishop. I called and my sister answered the phone, and my mother was sleep, not feeling well. And so we hung up, and then somehow she woke up. My sister said, Bishop Daniels called, and she said, call him back. They called me on my cell phone. I'm sitting in front of this phantom Rolls Royce. I ride better than I drive. Ain't nothing wrong with it. Amen. We'll take your vehicle and I'll be smiling. But I handed him the phone and he had this conversation with my mom. And then for some reason, he hands me the phone back. My mother, the call had ended. And so we went on. The next day was Tuesday. I was leaving to go back, come back home. And I'm in the airport at the gate and my sister calls. My sister said, you have to get to Buffalo right away. Mommy is taking a turn for the worse. I didn't know at that moment whether I should run from St. Louis to Buffalo. I didn't know what to do. But I stood in that line and I bought a ticket on Delta that when I land in Atlanta, I'm going right to Buffalo. Land in Buffalo that evening. And the first thing, as soon as we landed, I called my sister. And I said, where are you? And for the first time in a decade, my sister said, I'm at home. It's on you now. And I knew that if Lisa wasn't with my mother, I knew God was about to take her. I rushed from the airport to the hospital. My mother had a DNR, a do not resuscitate. That moment, they couldn't find it. And Lisa said, my brother is on his way. And when she said, it's up to you now, they still hadn't found it by the time I got there. And when I got there, they found the DNR. But my mother was on life support. They took my mother off of life support, and I held my mom in my arms. Because I was just glad that she wasn't gone before I could get to her. My mother has been everything to me. My sister and my mother, my baby sister who's already with the Lord, my brothers, but my family made ministry work. Moving here was so tough because I was by myself. But my sister preserved my mom's life. She attended to her at every turn. And then when my mother passed, my sister transferred her job and she came and she's been with me for 2 years. In that 2 years, she's had some health challenges. And there's nothing I wouldn't do for my sister because there's nothing she wouldn't do for our mom. Bittersweet, my sister's returning back to Buffalo. So this is her last service in person for a while. And I want to publicly, Lisa is not a limelighter. She doesn't ask for anything. But she is an amazing woman. She is a tremendous friend. She is a great sister. And today is her last Sunday in person. She was Greater Nation before there was ever a Greater Nation. And she'll continue to serve and to be a part of the things that we can do while she's here. But I want to take a moment to honor the woman that honored our mother. And that is my sister, Lisa Marie Brown.
Amen. So we're going to go to Lisa. This is a bittersweet moment. Nevertheless, we're grateful for the moment because it's the moments that make up our lives. And so if all the female clergy would please stand. If you're female clergy, please stand. I'm going to ask everyone else to just kind of take your seat for a moment because I need the female clergy. I need Lisa to see her sisters this morning. Amen. So, Lisa, on behalf of your brother, our bishop, our pastor, your sisters who love you dearly, we can't top what has just been said, but from our hearts, we need to let you know how much we appreciate you. Your presence here has been meant the world, not because you're his sister, but because you're Lisa Brown. Because you're uniquely you, amen? And so on behalf of the female clergy, we have a couple little tokens here just to say we love you and we're gonna miss you. This is, when you see it, you'll laugh, you'll smile, amen? This right here, you're gonna love this, amen? Everybody loves an envelope with a card in it, right? So on behalf of female clergy, sis, we love you, we thank God for you. And when you put these in the water tonight, just remember, each one of these represent one of your sisters. Each one of us is so unique, but we all have been created for a purpose. And our purpose right now is just to love on you, to let you know that you're all that and some. Whatever you do, just stay the course. Stay the course. Be uniquely you. Be you on purpose, intentionally. And continue to trust God no matter what it looks like, no matter what it feels like, no matter what's staring you in the face. Continue to hold on to God's unchanging hand. We love you. Amen. To God be the glory. Can we give it up for our sister this morning?
will.
I will.
I shall.
I shall.
I must.
I must bless your holy name.
I owe it all to you.
It's yours,
Lord.
bless the Lord. We owe it all to him. We owe it all to him. While you're standing, just look at somebody near you and just say, Happy Resurrection Day. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We owe it all to thee. Beloved, if you did not believe in the person of Jesus, then you wouldn't even be here. So I'm under no obligation or burden to convince you about the person of Christ. Many of us have walked ceremonially and commemoratively through Holy Week. We have recounted that on Wednesday that Judas, his friend, sold him out. Resurrection is foundational to our faith. We can all agree that had he not risen, then our faith is suspect and it's fraudulent. Resurrection is fundamental to why we're here. We, on the other hand, have a different perspective of resurrection because we didn't see it firsthand. So we believe what others have said and their eyewitness accounts. We've heard them. We read the Bible and we've read the story of the resurrection. And so let me give this to you in 7 minutes. Matthew 28:6 simply says this: He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come see where his body was laying. In 7 minutes, I want to talk to you about the resurrection from a conversation of hope. Not to convince you to try Jesus, but to say to you that his resurrection was fundamental to your mental health. His resurrection is fundamental to our emotional life. His resurrection is fundamental to everything that will occur in our life and to give to us the ability to have hope to press past where we are. Jesus comes to die for you and I. And we celebrated, we shouted, Lord, did we shout? Because his life was our life. In him we live. In him we move. And in him we have our being. Matter of fact, Galatians 2:20 says this: I am crucified. I love this word, with. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But yet not I, but Christ lives in me. The life that I now live in the flesh is by the power of the Son of God. It's my faith believing that Jesus, first of all, was born. I love Matthew, and for us that are studying scripture, Matthew writes to the Jews, and Matthew says that Jesus was a legitimate Jew who came to die for the world. Well, he went through great lengths to posture his legitimacy. He talks about who his mama is and his grandmama, and he goes through 42 generations to prove to Jews that Jesus was legit. Can you preach with me in this next 5 minutes and say, Jesus is legit? So listen, if he was legit, he was legitimately born, right? And he legitimately lived. So we know he had a profession. We know that he had a mom. He had a dad. He had a family. We know that he had a job. Touch your neighbor and say, Jesus worked. How come you ain't working? Oh, see, y'all don't like my kind of Jesus. Jesus wasn't running around talking about I'm the Son of God, zapping out meals, creating money. Jesus worked. So he had employment. He had family. He had responsibilities. He was legit. So he was legitimately born. He was legitimately the Messiah. He legitimately worked. He legitimately lived. And watch this. He legitimately died. Everything had to be legit for you and I to be saved. We could not be saved on a story, on a myth, on an anthology. We couldn't be saved on a hallucination. We couldn't be saved on a philosophy. We needed anthropological evidence that Jesus was a person. We needed evidence, sociological evidence, that he lived in community. Jesus would live. He was born and he was raised in the ghetto. He was a fugitive as a child. He had a tough life. He was poor. And he was an advocate. Jesus looked out for folk. And so he has this record of legitimacy. He was born, he lived, he died. Now the dying part was tough. Because how we get to him dying is that his friend sold him out. And the friends that walked with him wasn't with him in his worst moment. But yet he died for you and I. He walked passionately to Calvary that he might be the Son of God, even when God himself in his dying moment removes himself. He's humiliated. He's beaten. He's talked about like a dog, and he's dragged from judgment hall to judgment hall. We have all the records. And then he died. He was graveyard dead. So watch this. He wasn't an angel that came down and died. And then, no, he was 100% man and 100% God, and his man died. Because he had to die as a man, otherwise he wouldn't understand what humanity goes through. You can't die for me unless you know my life. You can't die for me unless you've been where I've been. You can't die for me unless you had my struggles. Jesus, if you've never been homeless. Jesus, if you've never been broke, if you've never been the bastard child of a single mom. Yeah, I'm messing with your theology. Then you can't die for me if you've never been tempted. If you've never been so angry that you want to call down legions of angels to wipe out your people. If you haven't ever been set up, if you've never been talked about it, if you've never come on here, if somebody has never bamboozled you, Jesus, you're not, you might be legitimate, but not for me. But the Bible says he was tempted in all points like we are, yet without sin. He shows us that you can have frenemies and still win. He shows us that you can eat with John and Judas at the same table and love them the same way. He shows us that his purpose was greater than his preference, because his preference in Gethsemane was, Lord, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, your purpose is greater than my preference. Come on, lean on somebody and say, how about you? Is your purpose greater than your preference? Do you prefer you more than the purpose of God in your life? 2 minutes, got to go. He legitimately dies. How do we know? Because we've got records. These same fools that set Jesus up went to Pilate and said, give us some soldiers and seal the tomb so that his disciples don't come and steal him. Pilate said, take the soldiers, seal the tomb, and put my seal, my signet, the government seal that Jesus is dead. Hallelujah. But on the third day, hey, come on, I feel my Baptist coming on. He died on Friday. Didn't he die? I know he died. On Saturday, everything got quiet. Jesus goes into hell and becomes the King of Kings, and he defeats death and the grave. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. Heaven and earth is in his hand. And then he says to you and I, because I got up, you can get up. Because I went through, you can get through. Because I live, you shall live also. So we say happy resurrection. Happy resurrection. Jesus lives. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Now you can shout because you have everlasting life. Now you can rejoice because you have victory over the enemy. Now bless God and rejoice.
This is Pastor Brown. I know that you have enjoyed our service. What a powerful time of ministry, exchange of worship and praise. I really hope that you benefit from being a part of our virtual community. I want to share with you that after church, a lot of times we sort of break out and talk and say hello. I want to invite you to what I call After the Amen. If you will simply log on to this particular Zoom link, we will be there. Our online pastor will engage you. I will be on to say hello. We don't want to hold you. We just simply want to connect. In this world that is just so isolated, it's important that we connect. If you are traveling, if you are military, if you're a business person, and you haven't had the opportunity to connect to a local church, and somehow you connect it with us virtually, then why don't we make it official? We would love for you to be a part of Greater Nation, not just the Affinity Greater Nation, but literally a part of our church. You can go to our app, that's my GCC app, or you can go to our website, and you can simply register with us as a member, a virtual member of Greater Community. What that does is it gives you an opportunity to have online conversations. It gives you an opportunity to have a local church that will be able to write letters of reference to say, yes, we know you. And that it also gives you a time to be in a place where you can have a shepherd's chat. I look forward to pastoring you, shepherding you, coaching you, and getting you to your next place of destiny. And so join us for After the Amen right here. Just click on this link after service, our online team and myself. We want to engage. We want to say hello, and we want you to be a part of what God is doing. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. That's my prayer. I'll see you just in a few moments.